Hello, my name is Kasper Hansen, and I would like to present this joint work titled Projected Hamming Dissimilarity for Bit-Level Importance Coding in Collaborative Filtering. In collaborative filtering, we use the similarities between users and items to make recommendations. For example, if we consider user D and compare this user to user A and C, we see that D did have an overlap with these in provided ratings or likes and dislikes, and from this we might guess that D would also dislike the meat option. More generally, you would normally learn user and item embeddings such that a similarity score can be computed between them, which you for example can do using normal matrix factorization. For example, such embeddings could look like these examples, where the inner product between D and the gaming controller then would be 1 and the inner product between D and the meat option would be -4, corresponding to a dislike. In these types of models, each dimension for either the user or the item corresponds to some type of latent preference or property of either the user or item. However, in very large scale settings, these type of real valued embeddings actually takes up a lot of storage, and distance computations may be too slow if the scale is too large. A solution to this is actually to use binary embeddings with a very fast distance measure, which we'll look at next. Binary embeddings are also known as hash codes. In this case, we focus on m-dimensional codes with values of either -1 or 1. Of course, we could also use 0 or 1, but for the sake of notation, this presentation will just focus on -1 and 1. In the Hamming space, we can do very fast similarity computations using the Hamming distance between a user embedding or user hash code and the item hash code, which is simply the summation of the XOR operation applied on the two. However, there are certain disadvantages to this, even though it's pretty fast. So all dimensions or all the bits, they're weighted equally by definition, and reweighting would make it significantly slower, for example, if we had a specific weight embedding or something like that. However, more specifically, the zero value does not exist as it does in the wheel-valued cases. For example, when we had a wheel-valued vector, then some dimension could simply be zero for a given user, and then that would not impact really the computation in the inner product. However, we don't have that here as they are all part of the computation. So this is actually what we want to solve. So in this work, we derive a way to do binary weighting corresponding to disabling bits with no additional storage and no compute overhead compared to the Hamming distance, which will show significantly improves effectiveness for codes optimized for this. What we propose, we call the projected Hamming dissimilarity, and in this setting, just consider some user and item vectors, U and I, and then let P be a projection operator. We then define the dissimilarity to be the norm of the projection of I and U. Similarly to the Hamming distance, a low dissimilarity corresponds to the objects being similar. And even though you might think that this notion of dissimilarity looks a bit weird, then it's actually completely natural. In the Euclidean space, then the cosine distance, which is just 1 minus the cosine between the vectors, is actually one instance of our dissimilarity, assuming we have unit-length vectors. So it's something that's pretty common to use in other cases also. In our paper, we are mostly interested in the binary vector space, of course, of -1 and 1, where the projection operator is the AND operation between the two hash codes. Hence, by definition, our projected Hamming dissimilarity can be written like this equation in the middle, where we just plug in the projection. When we look at it, then it looks very similar to the Hamming distance, but instead of having the item hash code on the right-hand side, then we have the projection. And of course, the question is, why is this actually beneficial, and is it still fast, similar to what we know the Hamming distance is? Even though it looks simple, the projection actually allows us to disable unimportant bits as defined by the user code. But this I mean that all the -1 dimensions are -1 bits in the user code will also be -1 in the item hash code after the projection, and therefore only the dimensions with the 1 in the user code really impacts the relatively ordering of the dissimilarity values from the collection of items. So when we have a user code and then compute the dissimilarity to all the items, then it will correspond to ignoring the minus one dimensions from the user code, which essentially allows us to do this, we can call it a binary coding or binary weighting of the item codes based on the user code. Then of course, lastly, we had this problem that it was randomized slower than the Hamming distance. And we can fix this problem by a simple manipulation where we can simply rewrite it to contain also just two operations, where the NOT operation of the item hash code can just be pre-computed, and then we store that instead of the original item hash code, and then we arrive at the same number of Boolean operations as the Hamming distance, and hence it is equally fast. We now want to learn hash codes actually optimized for this projected Hamming dissimilarity so we can use it. To this end, we derive a variational framework for generating or sampling user item codes based on maximizing the likelihood of the observed user specified ratings, which means we are in an explicit feedback scenario here. So based on these likelihoods, we can derive a variation lower bound to maximize, but for more details on that, we refer to the paper. In this model, the user hash codes and item hash codes, they are sampled as a sequence of Bernoulli trials based on learned embedding matrices. And then once we have these sampled codes, then we can maximize the log likelihood, which actually corresponds to just minimizing the mean squared error between the observed user item rating and function of the two hash codes. And of course here, the function f of the two hash codes is just the predicted Hamming dissimilarity, and then a transformation of that based on g, which just maps the interval of the projected Hamming dissimilarity to the interval of the ratings. And then we can simply just optimize this using gradient descent. In order to evaluate the performance of our projected Hamming dissimilarity on the codes optimized for that, we use four publicly available datasets, Yelp, ML 1 million, ML 10 million, and Amazon. These have a very different number of users and items and density, so they present a wide variety of different settings. What we do is that for each user, and this is similar to related work, we randomly sample 50% of the ratings, which we use for testing, and then 42.5% for training, and the rest for validation. In these datasets, we have ratings available, so we have an explicit feedback setting where the task is then just to correctly rank the users' test items based on the provided ratings. As baselines, we use a real-valued matrix factorization, MF, which of course recently have been shown to also be very competitive to neural models. Then for the binary methods, we have a quantized MF, where we either use the mean or median as the splitting point per dimension. So for example, all values that are larger than the mean for the first dimension set to 1, and otherwise minus 1, and so on. And we call this MF mean and MF median. And then most importantly, of course, we have the two state-of-the-art binary embedding approaches, DCF and CCCF. And then for our approaches, we denote our variational hashing framework using the predicted Hamming dissimilarity as VH PhD, and then just VH for when the Hamming distance is used. Let's now look at some of the results, where on this slide we focus on 32 bits or 32 dimensions for the matrix factorization. Compared to the binary embedding approaches, we observe rather large, statistically significant improvements over state-of-the-art of up to 14.4%. What we actually see is that the even largest improvements appear for MRR, which of course means that our approach, VHPHD, impacts the very top of the ranking list, hence the recommendations that matter the most to the users and the ones that we really want to get right. So that's of course very nice. What we also see is that VHPHD gets a performance that's rather close to MF and really tightens the gap between the binary embedding approaches and the real-valued approaches, so which is also great. Of course, it doesn't perform better because you can encode a lot more information in 32 real-valued numbers compared to only 32 bits. We now do an ablation of which users are most affected by our approach, so which users really benefit the most. If we group users by their activity, so how many rated items they have, then what we see is that we often achieve a similar performance as MF, except on the very most active users with a lot of rated items in the different data sets. But still, compared to the baselines, we obtain significantly better performance, as we also saw on the previous slide in the table. We can of course also group the users based on the popularity of their items, where we focus on the average item popularity of each user. So in this ablation, we want to see if there's any differences in the improvements for users that prefer very popular content compared to the less popular content. And what we see is that it's relatively consistent in improvements across datasets, independent of the item popularity. On ML1M and ML10M, we see slightly larger differences in the least popular content, but generally it's pretty consistent. And this is of course nice to know, because it shows that our approach is able to learn embeddings specifically for the items that works well, of course, for the very popular ones, but also for the less popular ones, which is nice. Lastly, we also noticed that the training time was significantly reduced due to the projection of our proposed predicted Hamming dissimilarity. Specifically, during training, each item code bitflip only affects a subset of the user codes, specifically only those with a 1 in the corresponding dimension of the bitflip, whereas the ones with a minus 1 are left unaffected, of course, because they are ignored in the predicted Hamming dissimilarity computation. In contrast, for the Hamming distance, each bitflip impacts all the user codes, and hence it can take a longer time for a model to train. In conclusion, we propose the predicted Hamming dissimilarity, which effectively allows a bit-level binary importance weighting corresponding to disabling certain bits of the item codes based on the user code. Of course, this can also be seen as some type of personalization of the item codes to fit each individual user. Surprisingly, this comes with no increase in storage cost and no computer overhead compared to the Hamming distance. And what we see is that when the hash codes are optimized for the predicted Hamming dissimilarity, then we can significantly outperform existing binary approaches and even obtain performances that are quite similar to the ones of matrix factorization in real-valued setting. So I would like to thank you for listening, and if you have any questions, then please feel free to write me an email.